Hey everybody, Brad here. Before we get to the episode, I just wanted to give a little explanation of why Dave sounds a little off. Dave is currently being aged in a whiskey barrel, and he sounds a little distant and maybe a bit canned. Anyway, I appreciate you understanding this audio faux pas, and Dave should be done taking on the smoky sweet flavor profile from the barrel by next week.
The album concept hour. I am your host, Brad LeBaron, as I always am, and we are here for another week of the album concept hour to discuss another concept album, as we always do. And this week we are going to be listening to mewithoutYou's Brother Sister. But before we get to that, I'm going to introduce our co-host. We have Dave over there on the other side of the table. How's it going, Dave?
Pretty damn good. Hello, hello.
And then we have a guest co-host in the form of my brother, Kevin, over there. How's it going, Kevin?
Hey, how's it going?
Welcome back to the podcast. He was on our Run the Jewels episode a long, long time ago at this point. But we were doing Me Without You, Brother, Sister, and he happened to be around, so.
And he's your brother.
And he's my brother. And, you know, it's he can pretty much just be on whenever he feels, you know, he can just walk in here Thursday.
Yeah, that ability, just rush in.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, if you ever want to jump in the middle of a podcast, Kevin, you can just Thursday night. Yeah.
All right, yeah.
Halfway through, we'll just go, Kevin's here.
Okay, Kevin, what do you think about this song? We have a very special guest for you guys tonight. We have the drummer for the band Jazzcore Friction and a close friend of ours, Jonah Wilson, is here.
What's up, guys? Super stoked to be here.
Yeah, dude. Thanks for being on, man.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, we made it work. We saw you a few months back. Was it a month ago that you guys played in Madison?
Yeah, about a month and a half ago.
Yeah. Yep. You guys played a really, really awesome show. You got 86, that's the band, right?
68.
No, 68. So close.
You're thinking, in the kitchen.
Oh, like, yeah, you get, yeah, 86 that order.
It means you cancel it out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure 68, they named it after the car, the Camaro. 68 Camaro.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
okay.
It was a car that his dad had or something like that. I'm not too sure.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they're phenomenal. They put on another great set too.
Yeah, that was a really, really good show. Yeah. And you guys also put on an amazing fucking show. I recommend anyone go out. If you see Jazzcore Friction on a poster, just go check it out.
Where'd you guys play
at? We played at the Annex in Madison here.
It's been a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, they've been around a while.
And it was a real reunion kind of show in a weird ways, because like I saw like a lot of people that, you know, we used to hang out with back in, you know, back when I lived in Beloit and hung out in Janesville a lot.
Likewise. It was a lot of new, like, fresh faces like that I hadn't seen in a long time. Mm-hmm. For me too.
Even Brandon was there. Well, not Brandon.
Brian.
Brian.
Yeah, Brian Rondon.
I'm sure there was Brandon there too.
Yeah, Brandon is your brother, actually.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Who has a podcast as well, if you want to check out. What's it called again?
I am not positive. Shit. I've been meaning to get on there, too.
It's in my notes somewhere in here. But, Brandon Wilson has a podcast as well, and we're probably going to get him on at some point.
Absolutely.
Has he talked about Me Without You?
I would be almost positive that
like,
he has.
I feel like I might have seen it when, I don't know.
He's such a huge fan of theirs. Like,
yeah,
there's
yeah.
no way he hasn't to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Know?
Yeah,
sure. But he does a similar thing with albums.
Yeah, we'll put a link in the description of that podcast. The podcast is called Songs We Didn't Write, you dunce. Sorry, I'm blanking on the name, Brandon.
He's phenomenal, though.
I'll edit it in. Yeah. I'll just throw in a...
Like the voices in Gangland, how they're super deep. Like,
it doesn't even fit the
subtitle.
Yeah. There's a really weird noise in the background. We've had a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun interviewing Darren Wilson and Kathy from back in the day. So we're excited to have you on. Why was Me Without You's Brother Sister the album that you picked from this list?
Well, It's just so much nostalgia in the album. I probably was 11, 12 years old, I would guess, when it came out, and I immediately got into it. I listened to a little bit of Catch First the Foxes prior, but Brother Sister was what really got me into the band, and just their incredible music that they put together. It's it's definitely a nostalgic thing, and I saw Brother Sister and just thought about it and hadn't listened to it in a while, and it'd be a good reason to get back into it it's just, and I re-listened to it after not hearing it for years, and it's just more phenomenal than like I understand more about music at this point, and it's just even more phenomenal the more you know about music too.
I'm a huge fan of Me Without You. I probably mentioned on the podcast before, and I think it still holds up. I think that the production is very good, regardless of how you feel about the vocal styles or something.
Definitely timeless.
I love this band. I used to study that. This is like, in a weird way, it's like the origin of the podcast, because this is like one of the first bands that I went through the lyrics with a fine tooth comb.
Yeah.
You know, because I needed to know what everything was about.
A lot of depth.
Yeah, yeah.
A lot to get into there.
Yeah. little background on Me Without You. It is helmed by the lead singer, Aaron Weiss, who has a very unique like vocal style, you know, kind of a spoken word style.
Oh, yeah.
He was raised Sufi Muslim, so he's got some of that... mythology in his music and his songwriting, like with all the animals and stuff that comes from Sufi, like children's book of children's poems, I guess, with animals.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what the next album is a lot more about.
Okay.
You know, the next album, he really, really leans into that.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. You can hear it in this album a little bit, but became a born again Christian, and then he's kind of just like a hippie Christian in general or whatever.
Very spiritual.
He likes Bible verses. He's very solemn, kind of monk kind of dude, you know.
He's loving rock and roll.
Yeah, pretty much.
So he just gets a lot of good values from different religions.
Mostly Abrahamic, you know. Mostly Abrahamic. Yeah, like you'll hear, some Arabic here and there. There was some stuff in Hebrew. Yes, that's the word.
Okay.
Hebrew.
They had
the written language.
They had a song where they had a section of it in Brother Sister where they're speaking Hebrew, correct?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. So there's he uses a lot of tools at his disposal, and he's got a very poetic kind of approach to songwriting in general, and he's not shy about talking about how much he loves God and how this is like part of the reason that I love this band is they took a different approach to their relationship with God and their spirituality. Was more of a personal thing, and less about preaching to the thorn. What was it? Don't look at the thorn in my eye when you have a plank in your eye. Is that you know what I'm saying? That phrase. I'm probably butchering it.
No, I think it's from the Bible, right, or something.
Yeah. So although they had strong spiritual beliefs and stuff that they, you know, didn't shy away from, they also, weren't out there, like, trying to convert, trying to evangelize and that kind of thing.
They're just coming from a personal perspective, which is where lyrics come from a lot, is from a personal perspective.
And yeah.
You just had a lot to talk about.
Yeah,
for sure.
And that's what he grew up with, and that's what, this fusion of these two, Sufi Muslim and Christian worlds is a really, just very unique, interesting perspective that it's cool that he's sharing.
Sure. Yeah. Well, yeah, and when you put that on in a performance,
yeah.
and just kind of explain yourself. I wouldn't see it as trying to push religion on anybody by any means or pushing anything specific. Like
Yeah. And I think that they, especially in the later albums, really kind of drifted from the Christian music industry proper. Like, I believe nowadays they're just, you know, they're just a band. I think they play at some Christian places, but like...
I believe they went independent too.
Yeah. You can find them at any other kind of venue too. It's not like they only play Christian places.
Sure.
Yeah. Because I think they used to be mostly church-based places.
A lot of those fests have shut down too. Cornerstone doesn't really do anything anymore. They used to do stuff all over the country variously, right?
Like, They had experiments.
Sure.
I was at Cornerstone, California, actually. We played there. And that was probably a mistake, driving 36 hours for little to no pay and not much attention. But
it's the experience, Brett.
It was the experience. Under Oath played really good that night, and there that was fun. They tried to do other things and fell through. Life Fest had a horrible incident that you can Google if you want to find out about.
Man, I'm interested in Life Fest.
I was at that one.
What?
I was at that one.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
That's
it was heavy.
Yeah. Were you there after the same day?
Oh, yeah, I was there the day of.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, I was watching a stand-up comedy routine, and some guy ran in and interrupted the whole thing, and it was crazy.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, I guess we should say for context, I guess, what happened.
What are we talking about?
There was Life Fest is a Christian music festival, and they had one of those bungee things, you know?
Oh, they like shoot like catapult.
Yeah.
Yeah, and kind of swing.
And there was a malfunction and someone died.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah. It was super crazy.
Yeah, yeah. I wasn't there that year, so I was there the year before, but yeah. It was pretty awful. But anyway, yeah.
But yeah, that
Christian music festival is not.
Yeah, that circuit is just not really a thing, and I don't know how much that they depended on that for touring, but probably not too much.
I don't know. I mean, but it does seem like it's less and less about being a Christian act these days. Like, yeah. You know, like
you definitely kind of got to go down different paths.
Yeah, because I mean, people are fucking sick of that shit. I guess, you know, like because there's this division that's. Yeah, well, and there's an unnecessary division for people to for people to see your music and hear your music, and you know if you believe. We're getting really into the evangelism of this. We should actually move into a track and then get into more of this. I could talk about this all day.
We just sidebar this?
Yeah. We'll sidebar this. And let's get into the first track of the album, Messes of Men. And let's let Aaron Weiss kind of tell you what we're talking about here. Here's Messes of Men.
I still taste this kiss, that dull hook in my lips. Is the memory as useless as a rod without a reel? Drop. Seasick yet still docked. Captain spotted napping with his first mate at the wheel.
Ah, man, I love that ding dong.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Really adds to the
so many layers.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a nautical kind of theme for a lot of this album. Like this, you know, there's, I think, an anchor and stuff on the cover and fishes and everything.
I get that. Yeah, and in the music too, it's just kind of that vibe.
Yeah. And I will say, something I mentioned in a previous podcast is the fact that during this kind of emo period of music, when this kind of existed in, there was a lot of ocean, ship and island references.
Absolutely.
A lot of, like, in not sailor music, and not, like, pirate music, you know? It was, like...
Remember,
Tiki Bar type stuff.
Modest Mouse did some stuff like that, for sure.
I think it was a great, like, metaphor for, like, loneliness that people were latching onto. Like,
sure.
But, yeah.
There's, like, a seclusion in, you know, like, nautical life.
Yeah.
Because you're, like, on a boat, maybe?
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
You're at a lighthouse?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, this is another one of the groups that kind of went in that direction for their album. And it was 2006, by the way, that this album came out.
Year Year of Pirates.
The Year of Pirates. I mean, there was a lot of piracy going on online at that point. Like, that was actually peak
LimeWire
internet
pirates.
Piracy. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's pirates everywhere.
I remember thinking, like, if someone is... I really, like, the first... We actually had someone download my old band's music illegally one time, and that was, like, the highlight of, like, our career. I was like, dude, yes! Someone cares enough to download it illegally. Hell yeah.
Find them and contact them and send
yeah,
them
right, yeah.
a basket or something.
Right, yeah. I should have. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Spread the word.
Yeah, to tell someone else
Burn
about
like
it.
Burn, like, 10, 12 discs and give
yes,
them to your friends.
Yes, please. It'll save us on...
Yeah, we'll come through in town.
Yeah, yeah. We won't have to buy as much CDRs ourselves, you know? But how many albums do you have... releases do you guys have right now with Jazzcore Friction?
We have a 5-track EP entitled Summer Dirties.
Okay.
We have a 10-track album entitled Dart Bum and Lizard.
Mm.
And then we have a 7-track EP we put out this year called Hemipenes.
Hemipenes.
Hemipenes with an M. Hemipenes.
Hemipenes.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
What's that mean?
Well,
how many times have you answered this question?
Well, so I'll start with like a background, I guess. We had a song. It's very political. 2020 was a very political year, and our lyrics kind of mm-hmm. just like went with that because we made all the songs in 2020, or the majority of them. And,
yeah,
yeah,
during the quarantine and stuff.
Right, right. 100% yeah. of the lyrics were done in 2020. So yeah, it just went down a very political direction, and okay. We have a song where the line is essentially saying you need to pick the lesser of two dicks, kind of like the voting process.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we found out at work a few weeks later, someone went up to me and went, hey, do you guys know that lizards and snakes have two dicks? And they do. It's true. And if you ask them, if you Google the question, do snakes have two penises, the word hemipenes comes up.
Oh, and that's the term for that?
They're called hemipenes, and it's two dicks.
Yeah.
And the pick the lesser of two dicks. Like, we just kind of connected the dots
yeah,
there.
Yeah, yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah. That's really cool, actually.
Well, we thought about it.
And informative.
We thought about it, and we were like, oh, we've got to do it. And then, like, I had some skepticalness about it, but I was like, just the initial feeling we had when we came up with it,
yeah.
That didn't leave me, so we went with it.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and you can Google it nowadays to find out what stuff means. You know, when you had like a vague album and like back in the day, like, you know, it wasn't as easy to
just stared at trying to figure out is it in the song? What does this mean?
Yeah, I can't find it in find it in my parents' dictionary.
It's not in the mail order catalog anywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you Googled hemipenes, the definition will probably come up before our music.
We'll probably get some really weird videos, too.
Oh, God, I hope not.
awesome promotion.
What would that be, ZooTube?
Oh, jeez.
I'm sure that's already a thing, and it's horrifying.
It's just nature.
It's just nature, guys.
The Bad Touch by Bloodhound Gang comes to mind right now.
Yeah. Oh, Bloodhound Gang. But yeah, there's a lot of great lyrics in this track. I definitely, you know, we can't get to all of them. I'm going to want to in this whole episode. I'm going to want to really jump into everything, but I'm going to try to restrain myself.
We should try to talk about it a little bit, though.
I like this section in verse 2, though. Like, he caught me making eyes. This is after he's already at sea. He caught me making eyes at the other boatmen's wives and heard me laughing louder at the jokes told by their daughters. I set my course for land, but you well understand it takes a steady hand to navigate adulterous waters. Adulterous.
Well, I didn't realize you said adulterous in that line.
Yeah. Huh. Yeah, it was like, it's really really edgy for a Christian band to be starting
there are
with.
A lot of wives on this boat for some reason.
Yeah, yeah.
For sure.
It's like, whoa, Aaron Weiss is talking about like doing adultery in this. Okay, cool.
When you're on a boat, man.
Hey, when you're on a boat, man, you know, like, how are you going to, you know, you can't judge. But Aaron Weiss is saving himself, obviously, I think. He's just a librarian and secretary's son. But yeah, I guess we'll move on to another track. We have The Dryness and the Rain coming up next.
Comes in jamming.
Comes in jamming hard. here is The Dryness and the Rain.
In the sea, while the sea is in a certain sense contained within the fish. Oh, what am I to think of what the writings of a thousand lifetimes cannot explain, if all the forest trees were pens and all the oceans ink.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so that one, I definitely picked the line that I wanted to talk about. That line fucking blew me away when I was a kid. It just had like all these layers of, you know, first of all, the, you know, he's really landing the water and sea imagery, but also it's just kind of a mind fuck. A fish swims in the sea while the sea is in a certain sense contained within the fish. Already getting into some weird philosophy. Whoa. Shit. Oh, what am I to think of the writing? And okay. This is probably the best description of like the Bible that I've like seen. You know, it's the most positive, like, you know. But what am I to think what the writing of a thousand lifetimes could not explain, if all the forest trees were pens and all the oceans ink? So he's kind of saying that, well, I guess it's not like saying that the Bible is like perfect or anything. He's more saying that the Bible couldn't explain the grandiosity of God or whatever.
Okay.
You know, is what my interpretation always was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kind of like drawing a question to kind of people that are like legalistic, you know, like me and Kevin come from a kind of legalistic household when we were growing up. And that's part of the reason I was latched onto this so much, is it really challenges those legalistic things.
Sure.
You know? Yeah. I've read these lyrics so many times.
Yeah, I know. It's a lot to sink. There's a lot to sink in for sure.
Well, yeah, so, and you were saying your relationship with mewithoutYou is more music driven. You're more drawn in by the drums and just the way that it's arranged and everything.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I mean, I have a there's a lot of lyrics in it that I have a certain connection with, but yeah, the music is really what just really connects me to the band. It's just so intricately done and really well organized. The mm-hmm. members collaborate so well, and
they had
a particular guitarist in this album that just did incredible things to the all around music.
Yeah, I'm trying to find that right now.
Yeah, there's certain guitar parts where it's not necessarily the first or even second thing you hear,
mm-hmm.
but it's just such a glue for like some of the main riffs and tracks and stuff. And yeah,
there's not much repetition with it. Like there are some things that they use multiple times in a song, but like a lot of times they change it quite a bit.
Sure.
The next time they do it, you know.
Oh yeah, and they use a variety of instruments, like one for this track and one for another track, and mm-hmm.
This one they're really experimenting with instruments. Like I don't think they were using the accordion last album. I think last album it was mostly just the band's instruments,
for sure.
If I can recall. The drummer's name though is I want to say that Richard Mazzotta is the drummer. I think that's the drummer's name.
He's so fun to watch live.
He's
super animated, super goofy, kind of maybe dorky a little, but it's so perfect.
Yeah.
It's
not quite as animated as you, but he's animated.
He's incredibly good though. Yeah. Like, yeah, I can't even put myself anywhere near the level of talent he's at. Like
I know what you mean.
He's still just got such a great face even while he's playing. You know, it's just super duper cool.
Yeah, yeah, I'm just gonna say right here though, that's part of the live show you guys check out, is like Jonah just fucking rocks out on the fucking drum set, and Gabe does too. Gabe rocks out too, but we gotta get Gabe in here too at some point. I'd love to talk to him about his whole journey to frontman of a band.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'd be able to tell you bits and pieces, but his perspective would be best, you know.
Just a little boyo when I met him, you know.
Oh, sure.
So seeing him up front, like, you know, doing some some wild vocals and guitar stuff. It's pretty cool.
Happens so fast. He's a grown up, man. That's
I know. And sometimes there would be a few years in between seeing him, you know, and be like, oh shit. Yeah.
He's all grown up, man.
yeah. But yeah, this is The Dryness and the Rain, though. This is the second track of the album. Yeah, a lot of just a lot of imagery about bugs and water and nature. There's a lot of nature in general, I think, in his lyrics, you know. He became a freegan at some point where he was trying to only eat like discarded food, you know.
Okay.
Environmental and stuff. Were you gonna say something?
It makes sense considering like that line that we just went over, because he's just talking about how, you know, nature itself has more to tell us about everything than what what, you know, a bunch of ancient humans writing down a bunch of stuff could tell us.
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
Something in nature beyond.
I think
beyond that.
Me Without You, or Felix Culpa actually has a similar, like a song with a very similar sentiment, A Benediction, where they're talking about only fools put faith in that which burns, talking about just, you know, anything finite. And what was it? We're all converts to the new faith, the new church of commerce. Only saints are salesmen. Shit. Sorry, Felix Culpa. I'm butchering your lyrics. Neither saints but salesmen, or salesmen, but somewhere in between, talking about like Christianity. Neither saints are snail nor sales nor snailsmen.
Snailsmen.
Goddamn, I'm done trying to describe this song.
I'm all in for those lyrics.
Yeah. By the way, we are hopefully we did get in contact with the Felix Culpa guys. We might be having them on the podcast very soon. Finally made
That'd
contact.
Be amazing.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Yes. Hopefully getting Marky on for Smashing Pumpkins, which was the plan.
Oh wow.
Yeah. Because I'm gonna move on to the next track, Wolf Am I and Shadow. Let's do it. This is that song that I just said that it was.
She's graceful and green as a stem, and I walk heavy on the delicate ground. Oh, there I go, showing off again, self-impressed by how well I can put myself down. And then I go again to the next further removed level of that same exact...
Ah, goddamn.
Awesome.
Just makes you want to...
It's rocking.
Rock.
Yeah, that when that riff comes in, the down, like in that second section of the verse. Oh, man.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
Yeah. Oh, my God. This, like, that's the thing. Like, this is... It's an album that, like, really, like has these moments of, like energy. And then, like, I mean, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. But the next track, it slows way down.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But they're good at utilizing... Like, when you bring it down, you kind of put an extra emphasis when it comes back up, you know? Like, it's up, and then it goes down, and it just transitions into back to up really well. Like,
yeah,
they're good at utilizing, like, the light stuff and bringing it, it's...
Because some bands will do, like, you know, heavier song, softer song, heavier song, and do it that way. But, yeah, when you have, like, in-between songs that do that purpose, then you can... almost just have heavy songs otherwise.
For sure.
Which is dope. That's probably part of the reason this album rocks. It's like
very cohesive. The tracks are very cohesive with one another.
All the slower, like, you know, chiller stuff they have confined to like three tracks. And then the rest of it, you know, they can go all over the place. But this fucking track though. Like there's like the like there's like crazy vocals and fucking, I don't know, man.
Yeah,
the layers. On this.
Yeah,
layers.
A lot more. Layers. A lot more singing in like this onions. Album for sure too.
Yeah, he's definitely he's leaning more into that direction. Yeah, the first two albums, first album almost exclusively yelling,
belting it. Yeah.
And then second album, belting it a lot, yell singing, but yeah, it's really really getting into his sweet spot here.
Yeah, a lot of quality singing for sure.
Yeah, like, yeah. The guitarist that makes this kind of big guitar sound is Christopher Kleinberg.
Okay.
So the first three albums have Christopher Kleinberg as the guitarist, and he was kind of the author of the kind of spacey
stuff. Yeah, that's happening. He's such a big impact in this album, I think.
Yeah, yeah. I think they're still good friends. I think that he's still, like, you know, close to the band members, but
I would imagine they all just, like, seem super nice. Like, yeah, you haven't met them, but you just kind of know.
Yeah, yeah. I saw a video of them. There's like a series on YouTube where a guy like goes in and basically like a band tells him all about their van and yeah, like gives him a tour of the van and, you know, stuff. So it was a tour of Me Without You's van and
their MTV Cribs moment.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. Yeah, it wasn't very exciting. I'm not, you know, I can't. They're very like chill guys.
But yeah, I mean,
which is good.
Once you love their music, though, yeah, you kind of do want to like feel like you know them. So like those extra things are really cool.
Yeah,
for sure. Even if it's something that small.
I've always been scared though of running. I could have probably met him like a handful of times, but I couldn't get up the gumption to do it, man.
Intimidated.
He's one of the few people that like it just.
I wouldn't know what to say. I wouldn't know what to say other than like gushing.
Mm-hmm. Like, oh my God, your lyrics on this song is just, it means so much to me. This line right here, is that from that Bible verse? Oh my God, man.
Like 20 minutes later, still like, oh my God, another.
Yeah, and he's like, I have to go now. Like,
goodbye.
Yeah, yeah. He's very polite. He's a very polite man.
I would please picture. Leave. I can picture it.
Please. yeah, yeah, yeah. I don't know what line to bring up on this track. Again, there's so many that are they're good. The one I picked, I guess, was a really great one because it's again, this is in the middle of the emo stuff. And he's like self-impressed again by how well I can put myself down.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really, like, I think, like a finger-on-the-pulse kind of line at the time, you know, because all the popular music at the time was about putting yourself down, was about how sad you were and how, you know.
Early 2000s, sure.
So I think he fell into that originally. Like, he started out in that kind of emo, like, depressed, suicidal world.
Sure.
And then, you know, this is where he's kind of, I think he's mostly past it at this point.
Yeah.
Then the next album, he's very much past it.
Yeah. And it's a breath of fresh air, too, because you do kind of sometimes feel surrounded by, like, some negative message lyrics and artists.
Yeah.
And
yeah, it was
just
a nice,
kind of a good breath of fresh air.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
You just got to get a boat and just go somewhere.
Sometimes you just got to sail away with Aaron Weiss. And, you know, maybe let him flirt with your daughter a little bit. You know?
Hey, he's not adulterous. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's what he's doing, I guess. Yeah, yeah. I'm assuming she's of age, guys, all right? They don't specify in the song, but let's just hope for Aaron Weiss's sake.
I mean, he does have,
Aaron
like...
Weiss is canceled.
He does have, like... He does have multiple meanings, because, like, in the album after this, he does have a song where he says, Allah, Allah. But Allah means something in a different language that isn't... People took it incorrectly, like they thought it was the Muslim religion Allah, but it's actually like some other language and it means something different.
Well, it's like basically it's just like the Abrahamic, like the oldest one of the oldest Abrahamic words for God.
Would that be Hebrew?
Well, Allah though is I think Arabic.
Oh, okay.
Trying to think of what it was in Genesis though, because in Genesis God has two different names. It changes halfway through.
Okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's most popularly associated with Muslim.
So like those couple things, I think he has a few more than a few things that you could possibly misinterpret for sure.
I think mostly he's just Abrahamic. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like he's not afraid to talk about, you know, certain Muslim things, certain Hebrew things, and Christian things all at the same time. You know. But yeah, people were mad about that. People were mad about that song though. That was when I think they split with the Christian music industry proper. You know what I mean?
Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah, no, I remember that actually.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually have, I was going to cover that song, but I changed like some of the lyrics, to, Instead of Allah every verse, it changes to a different God every verse. So like Krishna, and then like I'm blanking on gods right now, but you know, it would go through like, you know, the gods of the world as well as Allah.
Super unfortunate that it had to be controversial.
That's the Christian music industry, though. Like, it's you know, it's a weird place. Anyway. You guys want to move on to Yellow Spider?
Let's do it.
Yeah, we got Yellow Spider here.
Part one of a three-parter.
Yes, yes.
The twine we used to use to tie up tight our tattered shoes. Twisted twigs and crooked cross. A necklace for the deeply lost. You builder with the broken brick. Mother to the baby.
So is each spider evolve like a Pokemon? Is that like they just get like an alternate form by the time we get to the end of the album?
I think it's actually the opposite of that, actually. I think they're
de-evolution.
Because it's yellow, then orange, then brown. So it's like
bright.
It might be like dying or something.
Fall colors. Yeah. I think leaves when I think
fall
of
fall colors.
Is it just malting itself? Is it becoming a brand new spider?
Maybe. I don't know. He doesn't really. We don't really know if these are the same or different spiders. You know, that doesn't really specify.
Sure.
I'm not really going to sleep tonight.
Yeah. Hold on. Let's see what the lyrics have to say. Now these lyrics right here. Building with the broken bricks, mother murdered the baby chicks. You made this world look so nice. I wonder what the next one's like. You know, I gotta be honest. I never knew what the fuck any of these songs were about. The spider ones? I never really clicked.
Oh, yeah, especially when I listening to this when I was a younger person, it definitely kind of just went over my head for sure.
Highlighted now, though. You made this world look so nice, I wonder what the next one's like.
Yeah.
Almost like it is, like, transforming, like, malting the cone and becoming, like, a brand new spider.
Sure. So do you think that is the same spider, maybe?
You're just changing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Changes. What if that was the next song, like a cover of Changes? Man. Would that be just?
I'd buy this album right now. I need that track.
Yeah, yeah.
You got Bowie in this? What the?
Yeah. Oh my God.
Great.
These guys have good taste. Wow. But yeah, there's not much to discuss on the spider this track, but
I think this album has the accordion intro. Like like they first introduced the accordion in the album, in the song, I believe.
I think this is the first you're hearing the accordion.
Yeah, at the end, it's just a kind of like a string song. So like the accordion stands out really nice in it because they kind of closes it with an accordion bit in this track.
Yeah,
it's really good.
Yeah, yeah. It's him playing. Aaron White's playing accordion.
It's Aaron playing it. Yeah, and he busts it out live too. Pretty
regularly. Yeah. Not too many popular accordion players out here. Just Aaron Weiss and
Weird Al.
Yeah, yeah. Now that's the team up I want to see.
Oh yeah,
he's dueling, so fucking
dueling
weird.
Accordions.
Yeah,
that'd be the
two
weirdest.
Completely different worlds.
Is there any weird joke songs they can make out of them?
Yeah, I don't know. I think it'd make a good YouTube video.
Play us
probably.
A song, accordion man.
They keep on trying to one up each other. I'd watch that. I'd at least give you a like. But yeah, here's another track. We have Glass Can Only Spill What It Contains.
Fantastic
not
line.
Not What It Can Take. Kristen.
Eyes closed, drinking warm milk from my bowl. Thought nobody hears me, nobody hears me. As I crept in so soft and nobody sees.
What we were talking about earlier, such an otherworldly vibe, kind
yeah.
of. Just kind of puts you in a different environment, sort of.
Well, yeah,
the studio, the quality of the studio recording,
and
the production and the mix and everything.
It's such a kind of like a gritty vibe, for sure.
Yeah, it's a really fucking cool effect. Like his effects pedal must be just the coolest.
Yeah, that guitar was just super airy.
Yeah.
Kind of like this was in the air.
And it's like, yeah. and it's kind of wavering in and out of like some kind of frequency. I don't know.
I feel like it kind of let the drums stand a little bit more forward too, and
yeah,
it was a really nice,
yeah,
nice
yeah.
Tom,
yeah,
use of Tom there.
Some good Tom work.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know what the cymbal situation was for this album, but the entire album, I'm just obsessed with the cymbals.
That's like, yeah, that's what you're focusing on.
And when you're recording, it's like the toughest thing to mix down in a recording session. It's just, it's so perfect. And like, yeah, it's just really good sounding cymbals. I don't know, just,
for sure.
Like he,
I never think about that, but that's a good point.
There's a lot of standard beats where you're just kind of riding on the hi-hat and you're just doing a straight beat.
Yeah.
But like, for quieter parts or like verse parts, he won't really be tagging cymbals. He'll be doing like a little tom cymbal hit, sort of like kind of not a straight beat sort of start.
Yeah.
And then it'll go into like the heavier stuff and he'll just be tagging on the crash and just doing sick ass like straightforward beats. But he's got
a lot of control.
Yeah. When it gets quiet to a quieter part or like a more grittier vibe and darker sounding, he does these very intricate things using the whole kit,
like
but he's not
soft.
Yeah.
Yeah, because he didn't have like a huge kit, right? Like it was just a pretty standard.
Yeah, pretty. From what I remember.
Yeah, I remember it being like, you know, a couple cymbals, like not excessive at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's sometimes a trick that like drummers forget about is like sometimes limiting the amount of drums you're using, like it forces you to think about bigger things.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Because if you don't have the Neil Peart thing or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
When things are stripped down, it kind of opens up your mind a little bit in a certain way. For sure.
I've always appreciated when someone could do that with drums.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And then when you ride basic stuff for a while, so then when you, for a part change or a new part in a song, going straight forward and having a simplistic thing can just enhance any flavor you add into it or fills. It can enhance like the advanced stuff. You bring in and out. And it's
great. Especially when you throw something more advanced into like a more simple kind of tune or something.
Sure.
You know, that's always fun.
Oh yeah.
It's like the basic building block. You kind of like lay the foundation and then like you just build off that and just kind of like crazier. Like Allman Brothers just got insane.
Oh yeah, yeah. They would just keep on building off of each other until they had like Layla shit going on or whatever. That one documentary that we always talk about. Gotta check it. Gotta watch that if you get a chance. What's it called again?
The Language of Music.
The Language of Music. We are again recommending The Language of Music.
I can't stress it enough.
Such a good documentary if you're a music fan. But yeah, there's a there's so many, so many great lines. Oh, you pious and profane, put away your praise and blame. A glass can only spill what it contains. To the perpetually plain and the incurably inane, a glass can only spill what it contains. Like, that's...
Inane?
Incurably inane. Like, there's some alliteration going on
there's
here.
There's a lot of... Yeah, there's a lot of intricate rhymes within the lines going on in this one.
And then that glass can only spill what it contains. It's just such a great line.
It's a great line.
Such a great shtick line. Like, it's
I don't
just
know
so
if
good.
That's from the Book of Sufi Muslim Poems, but...
Yeah.
It's a great line. It's a great line.
He's got a lot of those. But glass can only spill what it contains. I can totally. You can vibe with that in any context almost, you know.
Well, and Kristen thought that it said a glass can only spill what it can take, which is also a really cool idea, you know.
Yeah.
Like, because it adds like kind of a layer of like you're reaching your limit, you know, as a person, you know.
Oh, for sure.
And I like this. I've always loved this line here. I'm halfway listening to what she thinks she knows. We're like children dressing in our parents' clothes, saying, nobody knows me, nobody knows me, nobody knows my name. And I like, that's such a great way to describe kind of what it is to be like a teenager or something, talking with other teenagers about really big ideas. This sounds probably condescending if you're a teenager right now. But like, I'm just talking about like the fact that like, you know, sometimes when you're younger, you're talking about things that you don't understand with people that also don't understand, and you're just kind of trying, you know, dressing in your parents' clothes, trying on different ideologies, trying on different, you know, worldviews and stuff.
Sure.
You know, trying to figure out who you are.
Trying to find yourself, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So,
yep.
Yeah.
Don't miss being a teenager.
No.
For sure.
No.
For sure.
It's an interesting time.
You know, someone brought up a very good point about, you know, there's that, this is has nothing to do with Me Without You. You know, there's that old trope where, like, you know, oh, if I can only go back in time, like, you know, and with what I know now.
Sure.
Someone mentioned a good kind of gross fact about it. It's like, if you go back in time and then, you know, you're trying to, like, use that stuff to get with girls, you're using your adult mind to get with teenage girls, which is problematic because, like, you know, it's just like, you're this, like, maybe, like, you know, whatever you are as an old adult man, and then all
That's like a Back to the Future-esque movie about to come out.
That's
what it sounds like.
But everyone talks about it like, oh, yeah, it's great. You know extra stuff. It's like, yeah, but then you're just like an old creep in a kid's body, like,
it's like a,
you know,
taking advantage
of people.
Time rapist.
Yeah, right?
Like,
it's just, yeah.
You hear that saying all the time, too.
Cinemax.
I wish I could go back in time with all the knowledge that I
have. Yeah, yeah. But, like, you know.
I just use that as, like, I wouldn't be as awkward. Like,
yeah.
Just, like, the billing, but just, like, conversation, just not being, like, insanely awkward. Like, no, I can easily talk to you.
It's, yeah,
like,
yeah.
I'm not going to freak out.
But it could be sinister. It could be very sinister, but we don't usually think about that aspect.
I just think about Uncle Rico. He pulled that line in Napoleon Dynamite. Just talking about his football days in high school.
So, oh yeah, yeah.
Could go back in time, man.
Yep, he's like the example of living in
'82.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Matthew McConaughey and Days Confused, just like. Outside the emporium, just like.
Oh yeah, that's what that is. Like that was the he's the experiment of it. Yeah. He's the product of it.
All right.
Oh god. What was it? He says, "I get older, and they just stay the same." Yes, yeah. They just stay the same age. Yep. Oh, yep. Yeah. That was his start, everyone.
Hey, you got.
You didn't even know.
You got a joint. Be a lot cooler if you did.
he is pretty great. That actor is fucking McConaughey, legend. Here is another track for you guys, though. We got two more tracks, then we're going to take a quick break. This is Nice and Blue, Parts 2 and 3. Well, I think it was just Nice and Blue, Part 2. For some reason, someone said and 3 on one of these.
Then I saw mountain and I saw city steadily sinking.
It's so tough to pick a favorite track for this album. It's like impossible. Know, right? They're all just so.
Well, and it had to been
awesome.
Hard to pick the clips too, because like
there's
so much going on and so many changes throughout some of the songs and like so much. Like they do a good job, like in this song especially. I think you know it progresses to like a climax.
Absolutely, and they ended it incredibly. They just kind of had like the bass. And the drums kind of doing like a little soft ditty of what they were doing prior. And it was Aaron doing vocals kind of behind that. And it was just really cool.
Again,
the drummer in me is saying that's one of the drum beats that like super confuses your brain into like learning a different beat. Because like when he's clacking on the snare and hitting the cymbal, the bass drum coming in on top of that doot 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 doot. It's really hard to. It's like really trippy and weird to do.
I try to like drum along with it in the air or whatever.
It's
but
hard.
Like I'm just flailing wildly. It's not. It's nothing.
It's like you get it down, but then it kind of the end rewind like forms with the beginning, and it's just kind of tough to start the new measure.
Yeah.
After you learn the first measure, you know, it's just. That's
I'm like thinking about the part in my head now. Yeah, yeah.
Do 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 do.
Yeah.
Do 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 do. Yeah.
And I think that's that's Greg. I think Greg's his name on the bass. Let's give his name out here too. Greg Johannan Jr. I believe has another band as well.
Yeah, the bass sound in this whole record is incredible.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah. That's right. It was on Tooth and Nail Records.
Yeah, they.
I forget about
they
that.
They had a lot of slapping music in the early 2000s, man.
That was the label for
Project 86.
Edgy Christian kids.
Blindside, Norma Jean, Chariot.
Yeah, yeah.
There's an old
pop
punk band, Honeytones. I used to love those on Tooth and Nail.
Really?
He is a legend.
They're very like Ramon awesome. Cora.
Okay.
Saw him a few times. They're just
well, yeah, because they would.
They're super like, I don't know, just down to earth and just hilarious. Yeah.
I'm sorry, who is this?
Huntington's.
Huntington's? Okay.
Just like I say, yeah, just a Ramon Cora like pop punk band.
Yeah. Oh, man. I think they did have like a few bands that weren't like necessarily Christian bands, but it was like a mostly Christian label. Yeah.
Sure.
Under Oath
for sure.
Yeah.
He is legend.
Yeah.
I just like that I Am Hollywood song.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was another one of the Tooth and Nail.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah, I remember that that DVD with all the music videos, the Tooth and Nail.
Oh yeah, that's how we first heard about Me Without You.
Yeah.
We saw the music video for what was the track?
Memphis Will Be Laid to the Blade.
Paper Hanger.
It was Paper Hanger. Yeah. It was from Catch Us Foxes. And
oh, okay.
I remember thinking, like, what the fuck is this? This is
yeah,
weird.
Yeah, the first time I heard it, I was like, wow, I've never heard anything like this. I didn't like it.
At first.
The vocals are very an acquired taste, especially in Catch Us the Foxes.
But I found myself watching that music video a lot. You know, like it really grew on me.
Yeah, there's something interesting about it. Yeah.
Yeah. But at first, I was like, "The fuck is up with this guy?"
Yeah.
Like, what is this?
Didn't Me Without You kind of get into the scene too from the Norma Jean song, Memphis Will Be Laid to Waste?
Yes, Memphis Will Be Laid to Waste.
Was that
the quintessential hardcore Christian song? It is just start to finish. Man, just
the intro. The intro is just to die for.
Yeah, it's just like just drums going like, crazy. Everyone's just starting at 11. Like
everyone's grandparents love that.
It's a classic. They play it on. They play it on the radio.
We
a
would
lot.
Play that joke on our parents for sure. Like we would be like, "Okay, I got to show you guys this band," and then like they have no clue. They don't listen to metal at all. Like we're just gonna show you this band. It's like this new sort of weird thing. You just got to hear it. That's oh my gosh, yeah. It's
definitely Derek's
something
we like. Okay.
It's all about God.
Yeah, it's about God though. Right. All right. Whatever. Oh man. Yeah, Norma Jean, though, legitimately good band.
Absolutely.
Really, really good.
That first intro album is just the nastiest
stuff ever. Yeah, before the lead singer went to Project 86.
Like the hardcore.
Oh, countries. Yeah, The Chariot, actually.
The Chariot. Yep, okay. What, Dave?
Is it for the hardcore Christians?
Yes. Oh, yeah. All of this was for the hardcore
Christians. Oh, man. Norma,
this is the age of the hardcore Christians.
Norma Jean was just, like, the music was just violently heavy, just like and then that Redeemer album. Oh my gosh, it is just insane. Like,
oh god,
the best band
super
name.
Heavy.
It sounds like really, you're like your grandma's friend from church. Like, oh, it's Norma Jean. She's here.
You know, Norma Jean is the original name of Marilyn Monroe.
That's right.
Yep.
Yeah. So, which is it's also like weird, but I don't know.
Why
but it's
you
a good
keep
metal
that
name,
it's
I like, guess.
Yeah,
but
for sure.
Yeah. I didn't know though for a long time that was that's why they were named that. I was like, Norma Jean, that's a very strange name for this band.
Yeah.
I was like, oh yeah, okay, yeah. You know, Marilyn Monroe, she died, that was hardcore or something. I don't know.
Brutal.
Remember when everything was brutal?
Man, that was the good old days.
Yeah. Austrian Death Machine. Before that guy went to jail.
Can I get a
Yeah.
Get to the chopper.
On the live shows. Austrian Death Machine live shows, man.
That's when I first discovered the bushwhacker technique. Have you guys heard of this? Form a circle pit and you do the bushwhacker and it's where it's kinda like the safety dance,
maybe.
But you're closed fist and you're swinging.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was
Russell's the bushwhackers.
That's probably where it's derived from, I would guess.
The one time I saw them, though, I was in love, like, immediately. Their live show is is just something out of this world.
Yeah.
Isn't that the guy from As I Lay Dying?
Yes.
Which is another Tooth and Nail,
I think.
Maybe.
They might have been on a different one. But the lead singer of that band, Got arrested and went to jail for a while hiring someone to assassinate his wife.
Oh, my goodness.
It was a misunderstanding.
But he served his time. He's out, and he's touring again.
Oh,
so.
My goodness. That is craziness.
Yeah.
Now you're digging up all this dirt again, bro.
Oh, my God. But, like, it was up. When I heard this news, I was like, what? The As I Lay Dying guy? What?
How come I haven't heard of that?
It Holy sounds cow. Like it almost sounds like a joke. You know what I mean? It sounds like something someone would make up as a joke about this guy. But yeah. But Austria Death Machine, though, there was a guy on stage that would have a giant Arnold Schwarzenegger head
comically
mask
sized.
Thing, a comically sized. Yeah, yeah. And he would be running around and he would be singing the Arnold lyrics.
And he'd have songs called Get to the Choppa.
Get to the Choppa.
All that song.
Yeah. Rubber Baby Buggy Bumpers. I know we had a song about
the
that.
Classic.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know if
a Christmas
it was a,
album too.
I don't know if it was a song title or a lyric, but there was a It's Not a Tumor at least a few times for sure.
Well, you
for
have
sure.
To
yeah.
Use that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, man. Definitely recommend checking out Austrian Death Machine if you want a little, if you want to see something just weird.
Yeah.
Happen your stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I was so happy when they
Check
came
out
with their albums. I was just.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It was a nice little moment. Because it was also like, it was a guy from a Christian band, and it had nothing to do with anything spiritual at all.
Sure, it was just.
So, like, for Christian kids, it was a nice little, like, you know, escape.
It's just kind of like a
yeah. There's nothing we gotta be. We don't have to be worried about hell here or anything. It's
yeah,
just Arnold Schwarzenegger,
a silly gimmick sort of thing. But it's really,
yeah,
really it
yeah.
was really good.
Yeah,
it's really
yeah.
good with metal music for
yeah.
sure.
This guy grew that energy like any normal kid. It just wanted like,
and it's like with a band like that, that's almost kind of like parody-ish. You can kind of get away with having a more mainstream sort of metal sound too.
Yeah, yeah.
Even though they didn't really do that, they were still pretty underground sounding and like zigzagging parts. But
yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, I think that, well, yeah, I think now he's just plays wherever, but, yeah. Anyway, that was Nice and Blue Part 2. We don't have too much to say about we have more to say about Norma Jean right now than Nice and Blue Part 2. But I will say the music video for this is really fun.
Is that the one you played us?
Yeah, that's the one I showed you guys, yeah.
Looking at the thumbnail, it seems entertaining to say the least.
It ends with a synchronized swimming number from all the bandmates.
That is very good at it.
That is excellent.
Yeah, yeah.
Train for a few
there's
days.
A training montage.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah, there's a training montage.
Oh, so they filmed like the actually getting ready for it.
Yeah, yeah, the whole music video is them getting ready for it and then doing it.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, it's a very silly music video for Me Without You. Like it was.
It's like a boot camp, but they got their musical instruments and like, around.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Oh, yeah, having a visual to go along with the song can definitely.
Well, all the previous music videos were all very serious, you know, because he's generally talking about some serious stuff. Like Paper Hanger, I think, is about a homeless lady. The bag lady.
So you can't really do a synchronized swim music video.
No, not so much. No. This one, I mean, this is about some pretty, you know, heavy stuff, but not like super depressing or in that vein, you know. I'm sure there's a lot of like Bible references in this that I'm even not getting.
It's cool that they went down a different route with the music video, though, actually going out and
doing
something. It seems like
it'd
be, seems like it'd be a more fun option in it, too, like as far as like putting one together.
Yeah, yeah. It was a nice. It was
just
a nice.
Being kooky.
Yeah, they're just being fun. Just being weird.
Yeah, having a good old time.
Having a good time.
It was nice to see Aaron Weiss, like, you know, enjoying himself.
Sure.
You know? He struggled with depression and stuff the first couple albums. But yeah, I want to move on to one more track, then we can take a little break.
Yeah.
This is The Sun and the Moon, and it's track 7.
Awesome. That bass, bass for days.
Yeah, yeah. this song really, this is one of the first times you really hear him really get into the singing.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, he's not doing a lot of stuff here. It's like more
And it's kind of got like this really cool delivery, almost not that fully, but like a slight sort of monotone.
Yeah.
You know, like I wanna see you. Like, it's kind of like
very unexciting for him.
but it fits the vibe really, really almost perfectly.
Yeah.
Like it's like
everything is perfect. The bass, the drums, the vocals, how they played it out.
Yeah.
Just,
absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. You really lose yourself in this one.
But yeah, I mean.
Yeah.
But yeah, he kind of had like that sort of monotonic vibe, but it's also just really pretty sounding with the music.
It's a longer track too. It definitely takes its time, more so than some of the previous tracks.
Is that 5:16? Is that what it says down there?
What's up?
5:16.
Yes.
Oh wow, yeah.
Yeah. I think most of them are like 4.5 or 4.
Which are still pretty lengthy.
Yeah.
Four and a half even. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Especially if they're doing a faster tune. Yeah.
Like radio, they only like. Have like 3 minute songs. You show me like mainstream radio.
Yeah, yeah. That's
gotta have put an ad in there somewhere.
Man, it's really too bad too, because like sometimes they're sometimes you want them to play another minute or two.
Sure.
Although sometimes, with like, what was it Bon Jovi? We listened to the New Jersey album, and those were all like a minute too long. So I guess it can't go.
Yeah, so there's probably a lot of songs you just wish it had.
Yeah.
And this one, like a minute or two.
The ones that do like a couple more choruses at the end, you know, like 15 more choruses at the end when it's like
Purple Rain.
It doesn't really.
But that, they kind of progress it. They kind of it's.
But
they add more.
What was it?
They call it the Purple Rain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh man, I take Purple Rain any day.
Take that chorus all day.
Yeah. We got to cover Prince, man. We haven't covered Prince yet. Purple Rain, I think that we need to add to the list.
They had a lot of great albums.
Things. It'd be a soundtrack and an album.
That's true.
Double concept.
Yeah.
And one of the greatest guitar players of all time.
Yeah, Prince. Yeah. Unmistakable. Yeah. Son of the Moon or My Father's Eyes. That's what he wants you to know in this track. I like that imagery.
Very personal sort of lyrics.
Yeah.
A lot of times.
Yeah. Very.
Like, not in a bad way. Like, like it comes from.
Mm-hmm.
It's come from his personal experiences and stuff.
It's like a mantra he's repeating to himself.
Sure.
It's like meditative kind of thing. Yeah. I like at the end there's like some piano stuff too. It was like, there's like a little bit just right at the end, like. Dum.
They sneak it in. They kind of just go in and out with all kinds of different instruments.
Yeah.
I think you just hinted at the clip how in this one they like really explore the instrumentals a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a real jam at the end, like the last 3 minutes or something. Kind of reminds me of Clint Eastwood, actually. You know, like the original version of Clint Eastwood has that like, really extended ending.
Oh yeah.
It's a little like that, just really light. Jam, not too much pressure,
Like Dirty Harry? Clint Eastwood? What?
The song Clint Eastwood by... Gorillaz. Sorry.
Yeah.
No context. I didn't say the band.
Oh, no, that's fine.
The song Clint Eastwood by Gorillaz. Yes.
I get that. Yeah, Clint Eastwood. Like old school Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, it jams out at the end, like... Clint Eastwood, you know how he jams out at the end? Every movie he jams out at the end, guys. I know it.
this song slaps.
Hell yeah. Oh, man. But yeah, Clint Eastwood was, one of those big, big songs when we were a kid, when we were kids growing up. It has a long fade out for that Gorillaz track on the original version, not the music video version of the track that does much the same thing. Clint Eastwood. we can move on to our break though, and then we can get back to the album. We have another one of those Spider songs for you. So
part two.
We're going to get to the second half of the album on the album concept hour. Welcome back, everybody, to the Album Concept Hour. I am your host, Brad LeBaron. Just in case you forgot, since an hour ago, And I am here with my co-hosts, Dave. Hello, Dave. And then our special co-host, Kevin. How's it going, Kevin?
What up?
And Jonah Wilson's here as well.
How's it going?
But before we get back into our album, mewithoutYou, we're actually going to do a segment on the podcast we haven't done in a little while. We figure we might as well get into it. This is What Is Dave Drinking?
I miss Scott.
Yeah, I know. We got to get him back as a guest sometime.
Can I kidnap him? Is that okay if I...
That's okay with me.
All right.
You know, I'm totally fine with that. You should, actually.
I'll work out logistics.
Yeah.
You're a panel man.
But this is What Is Dave Drinking? It's a segment where we go around the horn and ask everyone what they're sipping on. Dave, what are you drinking today? Oh, you wanna...
No, the first little guy was another half. It was the Deep Orbit.
The Deep Orbit.
Centurius, I believe.
Okay.
It's a stout with vanilla, fig, cinnamon, and almonds.
Ooh. Okay.
Pretty well.
That one was very, very tasty.
There was a lot happening there, but
yeah, there was a lot going on. Yeah, that was the first one you tried, Kevin. What did you think of that one?
Oh, that was a bit intense for me. Yeah.
Was it? Are you still working on that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
We were talking about that before we went on. It's funny you mentioned that.
Yeah. No. You'll find that some of these beers are pretty boozy sometimes.
Well, a little boozy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then the second one I think you have now is the Angry Chairs Barrel Age Krampus. They're okay. Sweet stout. And just a nice something like milk sweet stout, yeah. Little barrel action on there.
It's
a lot of wood.
Yes, that's the kind of stout that I like.
Yeah, it's nice.
Yeah, yeah. I've learned to like my stouts from Dave. They've been very good. And anything else you're sipping on over there?
Except for I had a Maplewood Pilsner in the early day before we kind of sat down. And also a Coors Banquet, because why not? What
am I drinking? Oh yeah, I'm drinking what you just mentioned a second ago, and I'm about to open a Corona Extra, but before that, I was sipping on a little bit of Founders All Day IPA Session Ale.
Mm.
Yeah, I really enjoy it, and
a little cocktail.
Well, what was the name of the
Coke too?
I was about to say, what was the name of the rum again, Kevin? Do you remember? It's 5 years.
I think it was
aged.
I think it was something sketchy like Plantation.
That's right. Yes, yes.
They have a lot of different styles too.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Try them all. They're...
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, it was. It's like a 5 year aged.
Yeah. Yeah.
Rum.
And then just some regular Coke with that. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Mixed with like a coconut water once. That was actually not too bad.
Really?
It's just like a
yeah.
Random, like, I'm going to try this.
Yeah,
it's
coconut
like, what's
rum.
What's in my fridge right now?
Coconut rum was the first thing I ever got drunk on.
I remember breaking into my brother's, older brother's, I was probably like 9 or 10, like, oh, this coconut. I'd put a little coke. I'm like, I mean,
yeah.
Why not? Because at that point, yeah. I was already, my parents were already giving me their mixed drinks and their beers a try before. I'm like,
yeah,
this
right?
Wisconsin.
Yeah, yeah. It's
like,
a different
no,
culture here, right?
You're insane.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, where's the RC? Where's the Pepsi?
Yeah, yeah. No, I really, really like the coconut rum. It's very sweet, though. It's extremely
sweet.
Yeah. But it's good stuff. That's what I'm drinking. What about you, Kevin? What are you sipping on tonight?
Mountain Dew Livewire at the moment.
That's okay. That's a drink. That you know. That's
absolutely.
You are drinking that. That's fair.
That's a beverage.
Yeah, yeah.
Orange soda.
Yeah. Livewire still around. I didn't know that.
It's the bomb, dude. It's the bomb.
Yeah. I'm a little
extra caffeine.
Yeah.
I figured
wouldn't
be bad.
I'm an OG Mountain Dew guy myself.
Big,
I'm all about
big fan of the
stuff.
Dew myself.
Throwback
too,
yeah. On that throwback.
The throwback.
Throwback Dew.
I don't know.
You mean the
wait,
real
wait,
cane
like, is that
sugar?
The cane sugar stuff?
Yeah.
I don't know. I gotta say, for the Mountain Dew, I like the corn syrup.
I was having flashbacks to being like soccer practice. This is what it used to taste like.
Oh, really? Because I never had that.
That was the power I remember at the time.
You don't know how much better the new Mountain Dew is until you have both kinds in front of you and compare them. It's like the cane sugar has a really good flavor to it, but like, something about putting extra sugar in it.
It's
makes it delicious. I don't get it.
It's definitely chemically, more chemically, I think, that with cane sugar, you know, it just, Mountain Dew is an irregular thing. It shouldn't exist.
I mean, it was the day back, I remember when Kick was out and Surge and all that were like, let's get some surge.
We're gonna get fucked up tonight. Yeah.
And then we're gonna sleep.
And then we're gonna sleep after playing video games until 2.
Oh man, Surge, dude, I love Surge.
Yeah, just, you can still find it somewhere, I think. Yeah, yeah.
Quick trip, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, what about you, Jonah? What are you sipping on tonight? Sipping on some, looks like some H2O there.
It's this is more vodka. It's moonshine. Yeah.
Oh,
it's
moonshine.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. See, it's because it's in a mason jar.
Yeah. That's true. Tonight. That's true. Yeah.
I've had about.
You've been drinking that moonshine like water.
I've had about like 3 of these.
Yeah.
It's water.
I'm
uber hydrated lately.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good. That's good. You know, hydration is
just mason,
is smart.
Mason jar. Water, I feel like I'm in the bayous drinking some moonshine. Like.
I hydrated all day. I got dehydrated.
This is just what we drink. I don't know what you want to tell. What do you want?
Yeah, no, just good old H2O. I just watched the Adam Sandler movie recently, too, so that's good. Yeah. The Water Boy.
Yes, the H2O boy himself.
Yes. I don't have that quality, my home at all, but I dream of it at times.
Oh, our water quality here is very...
very good.
It's actually hard, though. It's
I enjoy it.
We get a lot of layers of... some kind of crystally stuff all over everything after a while.
I'm not tasting it.
But, you know, maybe it's good for your stomach or something. Maybe it's the lining is... Yeah, it's good for your biome. But
it's got to be somehow.
Yeah, I hope so.
It's from the earth.
It's from the earth.
Yeah.
It's got to be good. But yeah, that's been our segment. What is Dave drinking?
What is Dave drinking?
All right, and we're just to get back to everything, we got Orange Spider for you guys, the second in the Spider trilogy. Here's Orange Spider.
Snapping traps and poison beans, far left diplomatic means.
Orange Spider arms me. Orange Spider orange leaf.
Orange Spider orange leaf.
Oh my gosh, I haven't heard this through really nice headphones before.
Oh yeah.
That backup vocal is insane.
Oh,
I've never picked that up. Hearing this on good headphones is
just
awesome.
Someone creeping behind you slowly like talking in your
ears. Yeah, just whispering.
Yeah, and it's echoey too. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's like even these like little weird songs are like well produced, you know.
Yeah.
And I don't know if he's like, I'd like to think that they are in the studio singing along with him, and he's, like, laughing, and they're just continuing going.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, yeah, I mean, Mike's will pick up certain tracks, and it's like, yeah, fuck it, leave it in there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I always loved that they left it in.
Three, like, random ones that are still on recording when you have other things. Or like
for sure
picking up like just the other like the background noise that's mm-hmm. happening
mm-hmm. absolutely
and so and it's right when it gets thrown into an album or a track and you hear like what's that
yeah
just this little thing
every now and again that's
and
fun
these little things you catch in a song or it's like, just like yeah like what was the
Was it Band on the Run?
Yes, yeah, so I was gonna say the
Band on the Run. There's a part where you can hear Paul McCartney singing during only a guitar part. But you can hear him, like, singing in the track. So, like, he must have been, like, singing while playing the guitar or something.
Like, or another mic, his off, like, in the one next to him or something, probably picked it up.
Yeah.
And just in the, it's very faint.
Yeah, just the faintest bit of Paul McCartney singing along with it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I've never noticed that.
We, like, stopped the podcast. We went out and I grabbed my record for Band on the Run. And we're like, wait, is it on the record? What is this? Is it just a Spotify thing? Like... And it was on the record too. Yeah,
yeah, that must be super faint. You must have to really fish to hear it. Because I've heard it on the radio a bunch of times, but I've never sat and like listened to it. Voluntarily.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
I've
yeah.
only caught it on the radio.
And just back to having headphones, and you started picking up almost the little things because even the sound system of headphones, you really like get immersed in like that
yeah,
song.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah, no, one of these days, I want to get all the headphones as these ones. This is like the best one in here right now.
Yeah. So you have that one?
I have the best one. Yes. Okay. I'm sorry. But, I mean, obviously, you guys no, like what you're
cool,
hearing.
Brad, that's cool.
But,
what the hell?
What the hell, man? This could be even better.
This is an outrage.
So there's a Patreon, I think. So I think it's supposed to be for new headphones. That'd be
that's
awesome.
True. Yeah, yeah. You know what? Yeah, do that for the other co-hosts. You know, the third or fourth co-host doesn't get the best of the headphones.
Oh, I got some good headphones too, huh?
Yeah, yeah. It's pretty much the two good headphones and good headphones too, but
have you guys looked into like how much top dollar headphones cost?
Yeah.
Like they're like in the thousands of dollars.
Holy oh, some of them shit. Can be. But like, I mean, I think you can get
that's like insane. Like what are you picking up there? Like alien?
I don't know. I would love to try those out and see what they sound like, but I mean, these were like, you know, like maybe 100 though, and I feel like these are pretty great.
Yeah,
I mean I don't know what else I'm missing.
We found a pair at Walmart that were like $60. Yeah. And it's pretty much exactly what we need for anything. Like we do it for recording, we do it
I mean, if you get, it's like, here's the thing, is like if you go to the like recording aisle or the recording section of headphones, it's like a different set of headphones than like
commercial
headphones. Sure. yeah and you find that you can get like higher quality at like a lower price. The only problem is the cords aren't kind of made for durability as much.
Sure.
You know, you can't be transporting those around all the time.
Well, they're just on your table, dude.
Yeah. So I don't know how we got into this, but we should move on to another track. This next track is C minor, and it's a good one.
Wide my door, my
C minor. Yeah.
I feel like it was taking it to church.
Yeah, yeah. A real, real, yeah.
Oh,
this
for
one's,
sure.
This one's definitely, has that in the foreground.
Pretty forward with, lyrically.
Church minor, I got.
Ah, yes. The minor church. The church full of coal miners and whatnot.
Very, the music makes it very easy to move to. It's a good, definitely a good dancing tune, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. There you go.
Oh, here's the line I mentioned earlier. I'm still technically a virgin after 27 years, which never bothered me before. What's maybe 50 more? So he was like, this is, you know, I mean, he's in a Christian band, so I guess, you know, it makes sense or whatever, but like, I don't know, there's not a lot of groups that draw attention to their virginity, you know? It's not really something that comes up a lot in music.
You don't usually hear the lyrical content to be that forward.
Yeah. Was it...
There is actually those ideas and those pressures within certain faiths. To stay, keep the virginity until marriage or whatever, you know?
Yeah. And I think for him, he was just, I don't know, he's like a monk or whatever, you know what I mean? He doesn't...
It's
not what he's about.
I think it's what sets this band apart so much with the lyrics, like, in so many ways and to so many different people, the lyrics are so subjective in so many definitions. Like, lyrics like, are kind of overlooked a lot of times. Mm-hmm. And, like, even the artist can, like, write lyrics and just kind of just slap some lyrics together, like... He's definitely definitely taking the
how he does it.
Taking the lyrics to a totally different level. Like you don't really hear any other bands take it to like such a depth.
Yeah, like this is something like, you know, you can there are definitely like I was about to say secular songs, but if you are not a Christian person, secular means anything that is not Christian. But there's some secular songs that do get into some, you know, really heavy, like Christian themes, I was going to say, you know, talking about their relationship with God or whatever. Like, I think that it's not always confined to the realm of Christian music, but, I like the sentiment here, even if I don't you know, fully agree with the sentiment these days, but open wide my door, my Lord, do whatever makes, or to whatever makes me love you more while there's still light to run towards. Which is probably the part where me and Aaron Weiss split a little bit, because sure. like there is, you know, a good inclination in, you know, this kind of faith to, you know, to do self-sacrifice and to always be doing that and to mm-hmm. looking out for other people. But, and the what would Jesus do kind of thing. Sometimes that can take the form of you not taking care of yourself.
Sure.
You know, which is something that I think that Aaron Weiss maybe learned a little bit later than this. This is where he's still kind of on his journey.
Sure.
Yeah, what were you going to say, John?
Maybe like this was a point where he was a little bit more wayward and like didn't yeah. necessarily have like even a destination necessarily.
Yeah, yeah. So.
Travel.
Yeah, wandering yeah. around, trying to figure out who he is, you know.
That's great, though. I mean, the lyrical content is chapters in his life. And
yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's...
It's earnest. It's very earnest. Like, it's a very raw kind of prayer, you know. Like, this is something that you would... You know, here in church or something.
Sure.
And
I don't know. And in many ways can be relatable, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Like, I mean, open wide my door could mean, you know, other, you know, things to sure. other people, you know?
Oh, absolutely.
If you take out the my Lord part, you know? But, yeah, no, I mean, it is, there is definitely something beautiful in that self-sacrifice kind of life, but, yeah, you got to also... You gotta also make sure to take care of yourself while you're doing it.
Can't pour from an empty cup.
Can't pour from an empty cup. Yes.
Oh, he was talking about the glass can only spill what it contains, too.
Yeah.
All these,
see,
there's some cup metaphors.
He's subconsciously, he's really telling us a lot, I think, in these lyrics. You know, he's going through
he
stuff.
He loves glassware.
Loves glassware. You know, he just really, he wanted us to know about his absolute love of it.
There was a line that he said. He said it was, the lake is ink and the... Trees have the pens or
yeah,
something
yeah,
like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's got a lot of yeah, yeah. comparisons.
He's great with those metaphors.
Yeah.
Man. He paints a picture really well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
Metaphor man.
He's the metaphor man. let's see what he's metaphoring about in this next track. This is In a Market Dimly Lit. Here we go.
Yeah.
The
needle's
worn, the groove's too deep. The needle's worn, the groove's too deep. I'm a donkey's jaw on a desert dune beside the bush that mows his soul. It burns and yet what not consumed.
Can't get enough of that. that heaviness, man.
I know. So I'm like, that's the one thing, like, as he gets more at peace with himself, he doesn't yell as much.
Yeah.
You know, which is, it makes sense. He's not angry. He's trying to, you know, enjoy his life or whatever and not get into that headspace.
Yeah.
But
the music is
God
very
damn
stank
if he
face.
Was good at it. He was yeah. so good at it, though.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
He was so good at yelling, angry. Well, I don't know if he's necessarily angry as much as intense, but, like, you know, it does, I don't know, I feel like it takes a lot out of you to do that, you know,
oh, yeah.
do that performance that he's doing.
Oh, totally.
But, yeah, this verse, though, is, like, I believe just a bunch of Bible verses just mashed together. I'm a donkey's jaw on a desert dune beside the bush that Moses saw that burned and yet was not consumed. She's the silver coin I lost. I'm the sheep who slipped away. We pray with fingers crossed, but you listen patiently anyway.
Hmm.
Yeah. There's Judges in the first verse. You got Exodus. You got Luke. You got the sheep parable from Luke. That's a famous one. People like the sheep one. And then, this one's not a verse or anything, but yeah. A lot of, just so much.
A lot of references.
So much in such a short.
Yeah.
If you're a little Christian, you know, teenager and you're seeing all this stuff, you're like, oh man, maybe the Bible is cool. You know, like. But someone that was kind of a Bible nerd, I guess, at this point in my life, like, I was just like, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, he's such a great.
Fuck yeah, the Bible.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's what I'm talking about, Old Testament.
He's such a great storyteller.
Yeah, he is.
For sure.
And, you know, and there are some
you know, there are some cool verses in the Bible, too. You know, that's one thing that, you know, as I don't consider myself a Christian anymore, but there's still some great fucking verses in there,
oh, absolutely.
You know, that I still think back to, you know.
Absolutely.
A lot of fire and brimstone D&D shit in there?
Not so much the fire and brimstone. Oh, okay. There's actually not much fire and brimstone stuff, which a lot of Christians don't know. Yeah. Not a whole lot of hell stuff in the Bible if you really look for it.
Okay.
But, you know, that's a little gem for you guys to look down yourself.
Hey, personally, I haven't read it. Yeah.
If you're traveling in the hotel, there's probably one place by there's, Gideon. You pull it out and just, you know.
That's true. Yeah, there's always going to be one in the drawer there, you know, traveling around. Maybe read the good book. Turn to Job. Job has some cool stuff happening. And Revelation, a fucking trip, dude. It's a real trip.
Right on.
Yeah. So he's referencing some Bible stuff left and right here. Oh, he got the bird that plucked the olive leaf. He's saying he's like everyone in the Bible, kind of. He's kind of like, he is kind of like saying he's like all of the like MacGuffins in the like Bible stories in this song, you know.
Yeah.
He's like personifying himself in that way.
It'd be something that he's kind of just leaning on in order to like tell what he wanted to tell, like, and he just told it in a certain way, or maybe kind of just
kind of to push the seriousness of what he's kind of
portraying, how it's such a key part of his own identity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like he is, like he's absorbed it into his being, kind of.
Sure.
Yeah. Man, I end up talking a lot about the Bible on this podcast, surprisingly.
Well, he talks about it a lot in the record. You know?
Yeah. I was going to say, one of these days I've decided season 3, we're going to listen to the Alacrity album.
At some point.
That's my old band.
Oh, all right.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And then we'll really, really get into it. Leading up to that, yeah.
This, the whole thing was is a long game just to get people to listen to it, right?
Yes.
And the last episode.
So Spurgatory Records can finally get those royalties that they've been seeking for so long.
It's fantastic content. It's been a long time since I've listened to Alacrity, but it's fucking quality ass content, man.
I am proud of the final product of what we did. It's just something I don't bring up much because it's just so different from who I am now. You know,
it's got to feel good though, like listening to it again. You know, like after doing it for a while.
I do when I listen to it. I jam out and sing along with it and stuff. Yeah, I get into it.
No other way to do it, man.
Yeah. I mean, when you make music, it's your baby. You know,
Well, and you think about how hard you worked on it.
Yes.
Too, you know?
Oh my God. Yeah.
Because that's the product of all that ass busting. You know.
Yeah. It's true. Yeah. And it got me on this path to doing the podcasting stuff at some point eventually. You know what I mean?
God, it's beautiful, man.
First time I was in the studio. Yeah. But we have another track for you guys. We have 3 more tracks, actually. This next track is, this one goes hard. This is Oh Porcupine. Here we go. Shit. I was just trying to figure it out.
Is he outside of the band or is he?
He's not in the band.
Oh,
he's not in the band.
So it's a feature.
Yeah. Cool. I was trying, because like, I was just looking at the lyrics and trying to figure that out because it's such a great vocal.
It's very, very cool. I figured maybe it was just one of the guitar players
Looks like it's Jeremy Enick. Okay. Who is the is a singer-songwriter known from Sunny Day Real Estate.
Oh, fantastic.
And the Fire Theft.
Sunny Day Real Estate, oh my gosh.
Wow, you know, I don't think that I realized that he was from Sunny Day Real Estate. I knew his name.
Man.
People were like, oh, this Jeremy Enick guy is, like, important. And I'm like, okay, whatever.
Yeah, he is. Great.
I'm going to do my best not to take this off the rails and totally dive into Sunny Day. Wait. Oh, my God. I could go.
It's a really great vocal, though, to add to this
Absolutely.
Song because it's not... it's not what you know hear with all the other songs. You know, it's a very.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's definitely definitely like outside musically, but I don't know, still meshes well. It's well placed in the song order too, I think.
Yeah, this is like the, I think, kind of like the climax of the album. You know what I mean? Like
slowly start bringing it down.
Yeah, yeah, because the other tracks are
Spider is the next one.
Yeah, Spider, and then the one with
Sweater
all
poorly
of
knit.
The harp and everything.
Oh so. Yeah.
Well, let me read this part here though. He mentions Messes of Men here for the first track, so callback. Messes of Men in farmer poverty, not much for monks, but we pretend to be. Share a silent meal and a pot of chamomile. Gypsies like us should be stamped in solidarity.
Whoa.
Yeah, some heavy shit going on on this track. Yeah, he may refer to his time and blah, blah, blah. Oh, he went and lived in a religious community, and they were very intent on trying to live out their teachings and sermons of Jesus, and trying to love each other and put their faith into practice and towards social justice and bring heaven to earth and living on earth as a kind of heaven.
Okay, so that's just kind of like a summarization.
Well, that's something. This is apparently he went to a place.
Summarization is a word, right?
Yes, that is, I think, one of the ones you can use as a word in the English language.
I was about to say summary, but I was like, no, let's church it up a little.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, I appreciate that. Thank you. Yeah, only the best on my podcast.
Wordsmith over here.
Yeah. No. I that's the kind of stuff that I will reward in the future. You know what I mean? But really cool. Like he's just kind of like ranting at this. Like in this song, he has a lot of lines. He's going, like, from start to finish, he's just kind of hammering them out, you know?
Got a lot to say.
Yeah, yeah. Like, this has got, like, the amount of lyrics as, like, you know, some rap tunes. You know what I mean? That's why, you know, in some ways, you know, I connect them because, you know, there's a lot of stuff happening at the same time.
Yeah,
more lyrics.
There's always a lot of things happening at the same time.
That they're both, like, based in poetry, in a sense.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, that's one thing I noticed about his lyrics in general is that, like, you know, you're talking about how much he goes into them and how detailed they are. Like, a lot of them do seem like they could stand alone as just poetry.
Oh,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, that's part of the reason I think I read these. It's like, man, I want to know what this is all about. Tell me, Aaron Weiss. But, yeah, we have two more tracks for you guys. We're getting on to Brownish Spider. This is the finish, conclusion of the Spider trilogy.
Yes.
It's a little better than Spider-Man 3, I think.
I was going to say, I thought it sounds like you're going to start talking about the Spider-Verse.
Yeah, I was going to say, I realized as I was saying it, I was like,
Doc Ock is back.
He's back, baby.
No more spider, no more leaf, no more spider, no more leaf. No more me, no more belief.
I really hope they don't fuck that up, man.
Man, he's really wanted to steal
Ant-Man. Oh, dude, I hope that they get married, like in the comics, you know what I mean? Like, that's the twist that I think we're all really waiting for.
Paul Rudd to come out.
Paul Rudd.
It's Ant-Man? I heard Ant-Man.
Oh, no. Oh, Aunt May, I think he said.
Oh!
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I heard the same thing going on.
Like, yeah, Ant-Man and Doc Ock. Okay, I could see it. It's progressive.
It's like, okay, I didn't know that, about
hey,
him, but...
Hey, you know,
got
I mean...
confused with the Ant and Spider. They're easy.
Think about the Spider-Verse. The Aunt Mays are very different.
Yes.
You almost can't compare the two.
Yeah.
That's how different they are.
But it's the same... Because you're going to be in the same verse as a whole different anime, which is like a joke. Like,
Interesting. I never thought about it that way. Yeah.
See, Me Without You was kind of doing like a hat off to.
Yeah,
Spider-Man
yeah. This is definitely a reference to Sam Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy. I have to believe.
With Eric from that 70s show being Venom for some goddamn reason.
Venom, you think the guy from that 70s show.
Oh, my God.
Clearly, the best Venom.
Yeah. No, definitely. No, I don't see how they could have a better one. Wow, yeah. I'm actually excited by the new Venom movie, by the way, guys.
I love the first one.
I'm kind of stoked.
I'm kind of a sucker for Tom Hardy, though.
Yeah, he can pretty much do anything.
He can do it all, man.
Yeah, and I'll be like, okay. yeah, he's just one of those actors.
Yeah, man.
But we've talked about MCU like we do once per episode always.
Almost.
And almost every episode comes up. Yeah, this is, you know, there's, again, not much to go here on here with the lyrics, because...
Do you think the spider is constantly changing and growing from song to song?
Yeah, maybe.
Well, one thing I noticed at the end, it says at the very end, it changes. No more spider. Yeah, no more spider, no more leave, no more me, no more believe.
Oh, yeah, you're
like,
right.
Throughout the songs, there's just fading away and, like, I guess expiring, maybe.
Yeah. Oh, fuck. Okay.
Well, and I think what Jonah was saying earlier, because it was like yellow, orange, and then brown, like the fall colors, like
bright mid-tone and then very dark.
And you know, I Do Not Exist from the first track. Okay, so this song, this album is really, it's kind of about his like reinvention of himself mentally.
It's almost like so intertwined to like it's where like a concept album almost.
Like. Yeah. Like I never thought it was all connected as much, but I think you're right. I think it is. I think it is actually more connected than I initially gave it credit.
Yeah.
Because I look at these songs very, I guess, individually as more than.
Yeah, and especially with more current albums, that's becoming more and more important. All of the tracks kind of meaning one whole thing.
Yeah. Like,
because we're kind of meshing into a singles world again.
Yeah, but it's kind of become
like stuff so, like Spotify is like trying to push artists toward that too.
Yeah,
because they can just
and if you
monetize it easier.
Yeah. If you look into any music marketer, they're gonna tell you if you're gonna release an album, make sure it's a statement in some way, you know, like a concept, as opposed to just like meshing a bunch of tracks together.
Oh,
yeah,
that's cool. So wait, so concept albums are in, is what you're saying?
They're coming back in a big way because as far as like listening to a song, it's kind of the singles. But yeah, no, like right now, singles are kind of where it's at, or at least like the music marketing research that I've found.
Yeah,
they say to release a single as a up and coming band like every 6 to 8 weeks.
Yeah, that's
and if it must be an album, make it some kind of concept or idea.
Yeah, because that's how like a lot of rappers operate, you know, these days, like newer rappers, like it's more about putting like you know, months of effort into one single rather than like months of effort into a full album, you know.
Yeah, and I think part of that is just the internet and how it is now.
Yeah.
Just like it's just such a flooding of different genres of everything and just so much coming in at once that it's almost like
a series of singles keeps you almost relevant if you're trying to like stay afloat above everything else. You're always pumping something out.
Two years
go by and now you have the album instead of like every 3 or 6 months you're just slowly pumping out like
two
tracks or EP or something.
Yeah.
So I mean like when you go on Facebook and scroll, it's just content overload.
Yeah.
So it's just like you listen to a song and then you go like I don't know, you go and move on to different content. Like, do I want to invest 45 minutes into an album? It's not really that anymore because social media just makes content so busy now. So
yeah, so singles, it's like TikTok or something, and you're like, oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So like, I guess if you're marketing your music, just like 3 to 5 minutes of your time, here's a single. You know, like then you can move on to. Your old content overload.
Keep somebody's attention.
Well, then you have like a band like King Gizzard, which.
Well, they're wizards, Brad.
They are lizard wizards, but they managed to put out full albums at the rate that most people put out singles. Yes.
Holy cow!
Jesus Christ! Wizards.
They're like, I swear, like twice a year at least they have a new album out.
So they just pump it, man.
They just—it's all they fucking do, man.
That's crazy.
In one year, they had 5 or 6 albums in the space of one whole year.
Holy cow!
There's got to be like several of the artists in the band have got to be like composers, so that there's multiple people like.
sure.
Oh, definitely. Well, I mean, it's a bigger band. You know, there's...
Well, yeah. Like, the longer band members are at it, the more rapid-fire songwriting becomes. Because, like, if you've been jamming with somebody for only five years,
yeah,
you know, you kind of just develop, like, a bond with them, like, musically. And pumping out songs can just come in so much more rapidly. So, like, yeah, yeah, King Gizzard, I would imagine they've probably been at it for a while.
Yeah, no, they seem pretty fucking comfortable with each other.
Sure.
Yeah, I don't know any band that has the same output right now as those guys.
Right on.
There is the guy that puts out like 50 track albums about states, but almost every song is the same. His whole deal is he has 20,000 songs, and I guarantee you none of these he took a second crack at. But that's a completely different story. If you want to listen to, if you want to learn about that, actually go to Side B, the Side B podcast. We get into that.
You're a punk band. You could have a 50-track album and still be 45 minutes. And
dude, yes.
50 16-second songs.
Or yes, yes, nice. Absolutely. Yeah, if you want to know more about that, check out our Connecticut album or episode from Side B on Flyover State TV.
Yeah.
So short. So there was a compilation. I think it was off of Fat Records. I think it was called Short Music for Short People. It was 101 bands. And every song had to be 30 seconds or less.
Oh, wow.
That was the first CD that I remember would break a couple of CD players, because when we got to the end, like, it didn't, like, the numbers could not adjust to, like, 101 tracks. It was sort of, like, getting, like, weird, like...
Oh, yeah. After
not got, even, like, numbers, like, weird symbols on your screen, like, okay, right.
After it got to, like, 99, because they didn't have... Yeah.
Destroy.
Wow. That's nuts. Yeah, no, punk music, man. Thrash punk, you know?
That's what's up, man.
Yeah.
Have you ever run into Mellow Harsher playing up here?
Mm-mm.
Oh, man. You should... I don't know if they play regularly
Mellow
anymore,
Harsher?
But Mellow Harsher is a thrash band around here, three-piece, that have legendary banter and a lot of 30-second songs.
Holy cow. Are they strictly local, or are they pretty... Are they pretty big?
I think one of them lives in Chicago now, so he's not local anymore. But they used to, one of the guys used to head up a venue that got closed down because people were burning some tires outside. It wasn't an official venue. It was the Vine, I'll call it. And it was kind of a secret thing, and
kind of
you
like
know,
a buddy spot. You know,
if like you knew, like basically, the posters would always have a V on it for you know, it would be at the V something, and
kind of like a word of mouth sort of location.
Yeah. If you saw the poster, you knew about that, this place. You were that, like, there's a show happening there.
That super exists everywhere.
Yes,
it's all hiding, but it's very existing, like, especially like in Madison for sure.
The ideal punk show is not OSHA safe. You know what I mean?
It's not up to code in any way, shape, or form.
It's in a basement where the house is like always like at the point where it might collapse.
Yeah.
Like that's where a sort punk show is supposed to happen.
Absolutely.
So, wait, this is a dirt floor.
Yeah, exactly.
Staircase that goes up. All right. Well,
the place might start on fire. You never know.
Sure.
Like that's a punk show.
We're seeing a band called We Start Fires.
Yeah,
it's gonna be off the hook.
Like, I would not be surprised if Dyke Haiju in their early days had actually started a few fires.
Well, that's how they got used to it. They figured shit out.
Yeah. You know, after you burn down a few venues,
they
you get used
to
it. You know, you get
guitars and drums
you know.
That they can set on fire and how much it's safe.
Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, no.
Trial by error.
Sort of vibe when you're in the bathroom and it's like, it's either a flyer, but like, I was just thinking, like, the OSHA, like, they always have the employees must wash hands before returning. I feel like. Like a punk house venue would have that, but only because they stole it probably from like a public bathroom, you know?
Yes. Exactly.
You know, urinal's the sink.
Not OSHA approved. Yeah. That's like the best way, the funniest way of putting it right there.
I will say the bathroom that venue was sketch.
Oh, man. Yeah,
it's
that's just like part of it.
Yeah, it is. It is. It is. I never used that bathroom. I would just find some random place in the area.
Like a corner?
That's, yeah, yeah, see, yeah. I'd go find a dumpster to pee behind or
it's
something.
It's times like that when you're happy you're a guy. And,
yeah.
Because, like, the pee situation is much...
It is easier for
you got a lot more options.
But the girls were doing that, too, though. You know what I mean? You know.
Hey, they're punk.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We got punk girls. They don't give a fuck in Madison. So, you know, they're popping squats. We got... Jesus Christ. This next track is In a Sweater Poorly Knit by the Christian band Be Without You.
So elegantly lyric. Such elegant lyrical content.
That. Thanks, Kevin. This is In a Sweater Poorly Knit.
So beautiful.
And you can go right back into the first track, kind of.
I feel like, again, the clip doesn't do enough justice to the song, because there's, like...
That one's hard, yeah.
This song has, like, some, like, kind of rhapsodic qualities going on with
Absolutely.
How it goes through the song. So
it changes up significantly, too.
It just grows, you know? It just does. Yeah, yeah. It is hard to capture this one in 15 seconds, you know?
So if you're listening to this podcast right now, listen to
the
goddamn album. Check the song out.
Yeah, yeah. Check
it
out.
Don't just check out for 15 seconds.
Yes.
It's just
copyright. You know, we're constricted by copyright. It's not our fault.
Check it out.
This was definitely the first song in the record that I emotionally connected with in a big way. It's such a moving song. Like, it's just really, really...
Yeah.
It's really, really pretty. Just beautiful melodies and... Aaron Weiss's vocals just go in perfectly with it, but that trap I caught for you seems to have caught my leg instead. Such a great line.
Yeah, it is. It really is.
The books are overdue and the goats are underfed or something like that.
Yep.
Yeah, it's really, really, really cool lyrics in it. And
I was going to say, one that really meant a lot to me back in the day, go plow some other field and try and forget my name. We'll see what harvest yields, and supposing I do the same. I planted rows of peas, but by the first week of July, they should have come up to my knees, but they were maybe ankle high.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And another thing about this is the opening verse, it's got an intense like sound into it, but it's just an acoustic guitar.
Yeah.
Their next verses are so intense and have the full band in it. So like you rarely hear verses, maybe like you would hear a chorus or something like that progress in such a way, but like the verses just get more and more intense and heavy throughout.
Yeah.
That's what I think part of that is what really makes this tune stand out.
Yeah, it just builds
along with that gorgeous ending with the harp and everything too. It's,
Yeah, I wonder if they have the harp player listed here.
Yeah, there's good live footage of it, and they got the harp player. They got the whole thing for every song. They don't miss a.
Did you see her
instrument.
On her own? When she was at Cornerstone.
She had a solo set?
She had a solo set, dude.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Her name is Timber. And she...
I think it might be pronounced Tambor.
Maybe? Oh, Tambor? Well,
I forget. I think that's pronounced differently, but...
Well, she is phenomenal. She was, a harp player that actually... I think she was in a couple other things that were significant. Her set was
I'm curious
amazing.
Of what her solo set was
oh
like.
God.
Was it all like
was just
it a
her.
Variety of instruments?
It was
like,
just her. Just her with harp.
Oh, just harp.
Just harp. And
oh wow.
Oh my God. It was beautiful.
It's like a rare instrument, I would say. You don't hear about the harp a lot.
And it was rare that you saw Me Without You with the harp, because she didn't like tour with them necessarily, I don't think. But when they were in Cornerstone or in like one of these, team up festivals, where all the Christian artists were there, they would.
It's easier to
play
do
together.
That.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, and that happened. Regularly in fests like that. That was a regular thing. Like bands cross performing.
Mm-hmm. Memphis will be laid to waste.
Abso-frickin-lutely.
Is always the, like, every time there was a Christian festival happening, everyone was like, are they going to do Memphis will be laid to waste with the original members?
Well, now that you've said that, Norma Jean, I'd say about 5 or so years ago, had a anniversary tour. And it was for Oh God, the Aftermath, Norma Jean. And they played that Oh God, the Aftermath in its entirety. But here's the thing.
Yeah.
Opening up for Norma Jean was 68, which has Josh Scoggin.
Okay.
So after they played Oh God, the Aftermath, there was an encore. And I started a Memphis chant.
Yeah.
We started screaming Memphis, Memphis, Memphis. Yeah. And Josh Scoggin came out and vocalized Memphis Will Be Laid to Waste.
So wait. 68, the band that was at the venue we saw.
Mm-hmm. That's Josh Scoggin.
He was from Norma Jean?
That's the guy that started Norma Jean in the Chariot.
Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah, that's him. That's Josh Scoggin. That's him.
Jesus Christ. And yeah. I didn't even say hi to him. Like,
he's a very nice guy.
So wait. Was the guy... Oh, maybe that's why I think the guy from Project 86...
Yeah, that's Andrew Schwab.
Is part also a great of, was part of Okay, that's what was happening. Yeah. A long time ago, someone must have told me 86. And I just... Oh, Jesus. 68.
I think that's what restaurants say when they're out of something. 86
like, eight. Yeah, 86 it. Yeah.
Yeah, 68. Yeah, that's Josh Scoggin. That's the Norma Jean and Chariot guy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's crazy, isn't it? He's still
so weird,
he's still
though.
Rocking.
Like,
now he's touring
that's
with
such
Korn.
A different like sound.
He's,
than...
he went from all this, you know, he went from all these Christian music circuits. Now he's touring with Korn. What a switch,
wow.
Huh?
Wow. Yeah.
And
I mean, you guys were talking about how much you loved this guy and how influential he was, and I was just like, yeah, this guy is pretty good. Yeah.
I can't believe you. I thought you would realize. Otherwise, I would have told you. That's funny.
Yeah. No. Well, I never thought.
But yeah, that was such a moment that happened.
Yeah,
at that show that I didn't think was ever going to happen in my lifetime. So like, what a total bucket list.
I've seen videos of that happening. But I've never seen it myself.
Granted, Aaron Weiss wasn't there to close it up, but it was still Scoggin and the new Norma Jean singer.
Yeah.
Singing it together, which was super duper.
That's freaking awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Ah, man, it's bringing me back to so many memories.
Me Without You is such an association with so many bands.
Yeah.
Like we were talking earlier before, like not live. If you have musical backgrounds, two people have musical backgrounds that go way back, it tends to kind of get off the rails a little bit and talk about like a variety of the bands you associate with that particular person. You know?
Yeah. You're in a specific headspace and you're kind of going back to that headspace and.
Yeah, because like I met you at Cornerstone, so that's like a big association right there.
So many
of our bands are in there.
Oh my God, yeah. It was a great fest. Anyone that got a chance, one day we'll have to do. I'll have to do like a, I don't know if I'll do like a YouTube video or what, but like. I feel like the story of like Cornerstone needs to be told. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, because I bring it up a lot on here.
There's footage of it a lot on YouTube too.
Oh, there is still. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep. But yeah, it was an amazing thing for your I don't know, just kids that from Christian backgrounds that want to rock the fuck out. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know.
It wasn't a warped tour, but
Yeah.
It's slap, dude.
Yeah, but it sounded like some of the stuff on Warped Tour.
Incredible musicians, you know. It's almost like the musicians were just as quality, if not more quality, than those big mainstream Warped Tour bands. But like, they didn't get that kind of credit, you know.
I remember seeing Underoath.
But like,
the
just
Warped
equally
Tour,
as talented and dynamic.
Yeah, Underoath was at Warped Tour one year when I went to Warped Tour, and that was
they're monstrously huge.
Yeah, they're
huge in a different way now.
Yeah,
I feel.
Yeah.
They play pretty different music
for them now.
Oh, absolutely.
A little bit. Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
They're old stuff.
They got Aaron Weiss back, right? Yeah. No, not Aaron Weiss. Aaron. Other Aaron.
GSP.
Gillespie.
Gillespie. GSP.
Yeah. GSP.
One of those.
He's back with Underoath.
Yeah. They weren't slouching too bad, though. They had the Norma Jean drummer actually drumming the album he was absent for.
Yeah.
Aaron GSP back is. He's like a powerhouse. He's got vocals.
Yes.
Incredible drums.
Yeah, and I guess the almost didn't pan out quite as much as he wanted it to.
Yeah. Well, he'll be teaching drums for life. I'm pretty sure he teaches, and yeah, he's going to be in business for forever.
Yeah. He's one of those, singing drummers. You know, it's really, rare.
Absolutely.
You know what? We're running out of time here. We got one final thing that we like to do before we get out of the podcast, and that is go around the horn and ask everyone what they've been listening to and what they have to plug. So I will start with you, Dave. What are you listening to lately, and what do you got to plug?
So this last week, I'll keep it short. Of course, I've been listening to last year, Beastie Boys, which has always been randomly playing. But today, I changed up for a lot of Daikaiju, because I'm trying to amp myself up for the show next week. And also Q and Not You, which...
Yes.
Last week, we were kind of prepping for this episode a little bit.
Yeah.
That band was... Just like their style, just kind of like popping my head a little bit every few tracks. Like, this sounds very similar to like that style.
Q and Not You, yep. Me Without You.
Exactly.
Coincidence? I think not.
I think not.
2002, 2003, maybe?
Yeah. Well, I think the one you sent me was from 2000.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it definitely predates.
Yeah. But so, yeah, a lot of, and also some stunning, I also sent you as well. So, a lot of.
Yeah.
Post-hardcore and noise rock.
Okay, yeah, that is kind of my thing.
Yeah,
that
so check like my, those,
my jam. Yeah,
that's what I've been jamming to.
Okay, cool. Nice, and what about you, Jonah? What do you listen to? What do you got to plug?
One album specifically, actually, I've been listening to a lot of Queens of the Stone Age, Songs for the Deaf. Dave Grohl's the drummer.
That is
awesome.
And I've been watching a lot of live footage of it and just how incredible Dave Grohl is. And that album is just so cool to me. Only a year or two ago I decided to get into them. They've been around for a while, but it's only like a year or two ago where I really wanted to dive in.
Mm-hmm.
And Songs for the Deaf was just
so perfect.
And that's what I've been on lately.
I think that's some of Dave Grohl's best work is when he's jamming out with
when he's beating on the drums, Stone
Age.
Man.
Whether it be them, Dirty Vultures, or Queens of the Stone Age, that's the Dave Grohl I like.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh man, them Crooked Vultures.
I think his band, is fine, but
them Crooked Vultures,
you know
is
what
phenomenal.
I mean?
He does is pretty solid. There's no like. Yeah. That's the week. Like, no, they're all really good. Like, everything has been.
Yeah, it's like good stuff. It's just like, I don't know. It's just not what I put on, you know?
It's like trying to pick, what's the worst Pixies album?
Yeah, he's one of my favorite, artists in general. But I'm not, I don't listen to his band at all. What's his band again?
Foo Fighters.
Foo Fighters, goddamn it.
I like a lot of Foo Fighters, but
I was like, wait, his band. What is his band?
I love a lot of Foo Fighters, but it's his side projects that are so cool. Them Crooked Vultures with John Paul Jones.
Yeah.
How phenomenal is he, by the way?
That little-known side project, Nirvana. John Paul Jones is cool, too. He gets involved in a lot of cool stuff.
Well, I mean, I just can't believe, how up there he is, but how incredibly good he looks and plays still. Like
he's the bass player, right?
Yes. He aged incredibly well.
So
I
guess he did... He was the producer for REM's Automatic for the People, I think.
Mm.
Yeah. Because I think they said it was the bass player of Led Zeppelin. So, No, that's he is a talented studio person. What about you, Kevin? What have you been listening to? What do you got to plug?
I've been kind of all over the place in some of the stuff that I've been listening to lately.
Yeah.
One thing that's been stuck in my head was this. I'm currently getting through season 5, Golden Wind, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Yeah, hell yeah!
And in the credits, such a great show. There's that big hit from Jodeci from the '90s called "Freakin' You."
Freakin' You. Okay.
Basically. Continuously stuck in my head because it's just super, super catchy and
it
plays at the end of each episode. I've been watching a lot of it lately.
Nice.
But
hell yeah. Oh, and
yeah, that and some Miles. I listened through that 2-2 album because I was thinking about that one you were talking about doing a Miles Davis podcast. And
I was about to bring that up.
And that album 2-2 really I gotta say, it's solid. We really could do an episode of that. But
okay. Yeah, we're actually gonna be jumping off of that. We're gonna be covering some Miles Davis at some point soon here. We're gonna get JoJo, our mutual old friend JoJo, on what the album? Podcast. We're still deciding which album.
There's so many albums.
Miles. No, there's already one.
Such a huge discussion.
I think there's like a few we're deciding between right now, but we're gonna try to not go with like the.
We're not doing Kind of Blue.
Mainstream. Yeah, we're not doing Kind of Blue. Yeah. Maybe Bitches Brew, but maybe. But there's also Tutu, which apparently is very good. So.
Sketches of Spain is up there for me.
Yeah. What?
Sketches of Spain is up there for me.
Oh, that's a great album. Yeah.
Sketches of Spain. Is the King Gizzard album Sketches of Brunswick a reference to that, maybe?
Well, I think that's something that's like goes back to some old classical stuff.
Yeah, sketches of
something, yeah.
Sketches of series. Yeah, okay. Yeah. But yeah, I'm really excited to get into some Miles Davis though on the podcast. We haven't done enough jazz on the show, you know. But it's also kind of hard to talk about.
Yeah,
but
not as many people know about it, and you have to. Yeah, you don't have the lyrics.
But this time we're getting jazz experts, you and JoJo, on the podcast to discuss it. So, really excited for that. As for my plugs and what I'm listening to, I've been listening to some oldies. Actually, I have a few records from I have like hits from the 50s and 60s, and really good stuff going from that. It's like they're kind of like the now that's what I call music of old records, kind of. It's like this, there's like 20.
Was it rock or doo-wop or what were you listening to?
I think it was just what's popular. I think it was just whatever is getting popular at the time.
The radio,
like the Everly Brothers was on like the first track on both of the records I was listening to.
Okay.
So yeah, real like oldies kind of stuff. Run the Jewels 4 I also tested out my new sound system on, and it was great. As far as plugs, I will say go on over to our Flyover State TV channel on YouTube. We are live every Tuesday night at 7:30 p.m. Central, switching between Side B and the Island. Let's see when this comes out. Oh yeah, tomorrow night we are going to be talking about Oregon. If you want to hear us talk about music about Oregon, go into check out that channel. Also, of course, please go to the Patreon, patreon.com/flyoverstatepark, and join the $1, $3, or $5 tier. All of those gives you access to Side B episodes, and we appreciate anything. We want to get some more headphones. I want to get the good headphones for everyone.
I want a new headphone.
Yeah. Dave wants a new headphone. So please go on to patreon.com/flyoverstatepark, and we can get Dave new headphones.
I'm going to hold a grudge about you having the good ones.
Yeah, right?
Well, don't worry. Now I know he's the best ones. I'm there.
I went to Brad's studio, and he gave me the crap headphones.
The inferior phones.
It's unacceptable. But do you have anything to plug, though, Jonah, before we go? I know you have that most recent album you mentioned, the EP. Right?
Yeah, we put that out. But we just put out a track entitled The Time Travel Song. We put that out. We put that out about 3 or 4 weeks ago. So that's a single. And in the last few months, we've put out 4 singles, actually.
Nice.
No, 3 coming on to 4. We're going to have a 4th track without a release date yet, but once that 4th track comes out, we are going to transfer the 4 singles that we've made in the last few months, and we're going to transfer it into an EP for CDs and vinyls and have you for sale and stuff like that. But yeah, we're just going to kind of compile the 4 tracks.
Yeah.
And we're going to entitle it Mishmash O Mamma Jamma.
Okay.
Because it's a mishmash of singles and it's a mamma jamma.
And it's a mamma jamma as well. Yeah.
Got a key in the mamma jamma part. It's important. Hell yeah.
Do you guys have a music video yet?
We have a couple from the EP.
Okay.
Yep.
Dang, I need to look at those.
Yeah, they're very DIY, but they're very fun. Yeah. The Lesser of Two.
Have you seen the Wood Chickens one that they did?
Is it recent?
No, no, no. It's the old one where they're in the field.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. That's, it's a fun DIY video.
Oh, yeah.
Video.
That was very well done.
Yeah, yeah. I enjoy it. Yeah, I think it goes with their sound and everything. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Cool. Well, then, we'll definitely go and we'll put links in the description for some of that stuff. And, in general, thank you for being on the podcast, though. I really appreciate it.
Oh, yeah. It means a lot. It's great to be on here, man.
Yeah. I love the band Jazzcore Friction. If you want to look them up wherever you can, Jazzcore Friction. And you will not be disappointed, guys. thanks so much for joining us. Thanks for listening to the podcast. We will join you guys next week on the Album Concept Hour.
Thanks a lot, man.
The Album Concept Hour is Brad LeBaron, Dave Gallagher, John Aker, and Jake the Snake Foster. Special thanks to King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard for the theme music. Join the discussion on our Discord, tweet to us at Album Concept Pod, or for everything else, go to linktree.com/Flyover State Park. See you on Side B. This is Flyover State Park. You are clear to land.